My name is Laura Clifford, and I work for the Honors College at Middle Tennessee State University, and I'd like to welcome you today. You've taken a step in learning about national opportunities and learning about REUs. What I'm going to do in this first part is just go through a lot of different opportunities. Some of them may be relevant to you, some of them may not be relevant to you. One thing you can do, because there are so many, is you can email me. My email is laura.clippard@mtsu.edu, and you can ask for a copy of this PowerPoint, and I will send it to you so that you can review these at your leisure. One thing you should know is there's just a lot of great opportunities for math, science, aerospace folks, and I'm always surprised at how many students don't know about them. So I'd like to take a few minutes and just go through some of the opportunities with you. These opportunities are for sophomores and juniors. One thing I'd like to talk about is some of the common themes with these fellowships. They are looking for people who are strong in the math and science area, and typically that means at least a 3.0. Sometimes it can mean quite higher. They also want students who are able to state their professional goals. And that can be somewhat tricky. Sometimes students aren't sure. And when you apply for an application, you are not signing your name in blood, but you need to be able to articulate what type of graduate school you'd like to go to, what your specific interests are in order to be competitive. You also sometimes have to have strong letters of references, so it's important that you spend time with your professor so that they can genuinely write you a letter. So let's just jump right in. So let's talk about the Fulbright. I will have to tell you that the Fulbright is one of my favorite programs. Okay. The Fulbright you typically apply for a year before graduation. So if you are a junior, you would apply for it. Now, if you're going to go do research, say in fall of 16, you would apply for the Fulbright in this cycle. You can, with the Fulbright, either teach English or do research. I'm going to focus a little bit more on the research side. There are 160 different countries that you can go do research with, okay? They pay for everything, and typically you stay overseas about 10 months. Now, the Fulbright can be tricky for a single reason. Most of the countries require that you get your own letter of affiliation. And that means they want a letter of support from a foreign university. How do you get a letter of support from a foreign university? Well, some of you may have done a study abroad. Maybe you went to Germany, or maybe you went on a trip and you got a letter that way because you met a faculty member. You can also get a letter of affiliation through networking. Dr. Preston McDougall in chemistry helped Daniel Gallagher get a letter, and he was able to study in Spain and study chemistry. You can also just cold call, where you email people that you don't know and seek an affiliation. What are the benefits of the Fulbright? Well, it pays for everything. It pays for your airfare, it pays for your stipend, it pays for health insurance. Sometimes you can bring people with you. If you are married and or have children, sometimes they can go on the Fulbright experience with you. Basically, for Fulbright, you act as a cultural ambassador. You're representing the United States, but you're doing research. So they want a student who's going to be involved in the community. So the Fulbright is a wonderful opportunity, and they love STEM folks. Most of the STEM folks who have applied for the Fulbright have placed in some format. Either they've become a semifinalist or they've won. So the Fulbright is a great opportunity. The other thing I'll mention about the Fulbright, which I love, okay, is the Fulbright has a long window of opportunity. So you can apply for it in graduate school. So say that you're not quite ready now, you can go to graduate school and apply for a Fulbright. You can graduate from MTSU and 5 years later apply for a Fulbright. As long as you don't have a PhD, you can apply. The minute you get the PhD, you flip into a different Fulbright category and you have to apply for a different set of Fulbright information. Do you guys have questions about the Fulbright at all? Anybody? There's also a lot of opportunities. And I would point out that the word minority can mean different things. So So the minority health and health disparities international research training is somewhat similar to an REU, and they pay your way, they set you up. There's 22 different sites that you can apply to. They go to a lot of different countries that are outside of Western Europe, okay? Uganda, African countries. They are looking for people who are diverse, but diversity can mean race, but it can also mean socioeconomic disadvantaged if you have a Pell Grant, if you're low income. And people from farming areas or rural areas are considered disadvantaged. So we had a student, Jessica, who went to Uganda. She got to do research. It was a great, wonderful experience for you. They're looking for people who are interested, obviously, in health issues. Okay, so this wouldn't necessarily be pure scientific research. The Goldwater. The Goldwater, is the cycle is still open now. So this is a direct invitation for you to apply. For the Goldwater, they want people whose long-term career goal is to work in research. That's what you want to do professionally. For the Goldwater, you have to fill out a very short 2-page form to enter the internal competition. And if you are selected by the faculty here, then you get to fill out the longer application. What do we look for in the Goldwater? We look for good grades. We look for people who have had research experience. Although it's not technically required for Goldwater, you have to write a scientific essay, and it definitely helps if you've had that direct research experience. You also have to have 3 letters of recommendation. The Goldwater internal deadline is October the 30th. I'd love to have you apply. You have to have, someone was talking about graduation, you have to be here through next spring of 17. Okay, so people that are awarded the Goldwater could get up to $7,000 for next fall and next spring. So you have to be here to get the money, okay? But you can apply if you have 1 year of college left or 2 years of college left. So it's a great opportunity. I would encourage you to apply. Now, they and this is not my rule, they don't like pre-med folks, okay? They like people who are going into research. So physics people, typically that matches you. Sometimes it matches biology. But the Goldwater is a national competition, but you won't win if you don't enter. Okay, I cannot emphasize that enough. So if you want some of these opportunities, take the time and please fill out that 2-page form. If you haven't seen it, because I've been emailing it out, just shoot me an email and I'll send it to you. This is a one that people can apply for now as well, okay? The DAD RISE. What is that? That is research in Germany. Everything is paid for except your airfare. The database will open in December. When the database opens, you have to go through the database and pick out 3 people to work with. They have a PhD students in Germany, and you have to have 2 letters of reference. This is kind of got a funny timeline. So this is one that you would do over Christmas break. So it opens in December, it closes in January, typically before school starts back up. We have had 2 winners from MTSU who have received this, and they said it was a fabulous experience. So if you are interested in applying for an REU, you might consider applying for the DAAD RISE. The SMART. Some of you probably heard of this. You can get funding for graduate and undergraduate, but there's a catch, okay? And the catch is they will fund you typically between $25,000 and $38,000, but you have to, in return, work for the Department of Defense. So some people really like that, and some people do not, okay? But you can apply for this at any point in your undergraduate career and any point in your graduate career, and it can definitely help you pay for graduate school. But in return for all these fabulous things that they list, they give you health insurance, they give you a book allowance, they give you paid internships. You are agreeing to work for the Department of Defense. The UDAL is, I'm searching for a UDAL candidate, is someone that wants to work in environmental issues. So if your scientific research is related to environmental issues, the scholarship, I think it's about $5,000. So just shoot me an email and let me know. The Truman. The Truman, I put that one on here because a lot of times people think social issues are not related to science, and that's definitely not true. For the Truman, they're looking for someone who wants to be a change agent in our society. It's up to $30,000 for graduate school. You have to talk about your community service, your service on the campus. They like people who have been active in government. They're looking for someone who is a change agent, who wants to do things in our society to make a difference. So you don't have to be necessarily extroverted, but you do have to be able to argue your points. So it's a wonderful opportunity as well. One thing that people don't realize is study abroad opportunities, STEM majors can receive additional money, okay? So the Bourne, for example, they have summer initiatives. They want you guys to get out overseas. They want you to study abroad. So you can get up to $8,000 for about 8 weeks to study abroad overseas. It's run through the study abroad office here. It's an opportunity for students to be overseas and not worry about the cost of it. I'm not going to spend a whole lot of time on this, okay? Because Dr. Sieg is going to talk about REUs. REUs are an opportunity to get paid for professional development. They typically pay housing. They typically pay your travel cost. And it's a great opportunity for professional growth and development. For the Gilman Scholarship, again, there are a lot of opportunities for students who want to go overseas in the STEM field. The Gilman is geared towards students who have Pell Grant. So if you have a Pell Grant, it means that your income is not here, it's probably a little bit down here. And you're probably concerned about the cost of study abroad. For the Gilman, they like STEM majors, and they also prefer people who want to go to less popular countries. So they're trying to send diverse students to diverse countries. They also like students who do internships or research. The Gilman is run through the Education Abroad office, but I am a Gilman reader, and if anyone is interested, I'd love to talk to you. So now we're going to switch over to information for graduating seniors. There are a lot of opportunities in the UK. I've listed a few here. We've got the Mitchell, the Marshall, and the Rhodes. Most people have heard of the Rhodes. So for the Rhodes, what are they looking for? They're looking for someone who has leadership. They're looking for someone who has strong academics. They're also looking for someone who is very energetic. For all of these scholarships, typically, some scholarships you can apply for directly. So for an REU, you do not have to receive permission from myself or Dr. Sieg to apply for an REU. But for a lot of the national opportunities, you have to go through a faculty committee here. So if you're interested in studying in the UK after graduation, and you think that you meet the criteria of having strong leadership and strong academics, and you have high energy, actually they say athletic, but they've changed that to high energy, so that you're just an energetic person, then you can apply for those. The Gates Cambridge. One of the things about the Gates Cambridge that I learned is that students that apply for this, where they study in Cambridge, and it's funded by who? By Bill Gates, right? When they apply for this, a lot of them get offered funding from Cambridge itself. So if you're interested in studying in the UK and you plan to apply, you should apply for this. And we have two students applying now that we're hoping that even if they don't get this particular scholarship, that they will get funded through the university. Are you going to talk a little bit about this one? Okay. So the NSF Graduate Fellowship, you can typically apply as a graduating senior. Graduate students are more competitive, and it pays quite a bit for graduate school. So you can see it has an annual stipend of $30,000. It pays educational cost. And basically, you can write your, you ever watch Charlie and the Chocolate Factory? You got the golden ticket? Golden ticket. The Hertz Foundation is about $20,000 to $38,000. The nice thing about the Hertz is its funding can be combined with other fellowships, or it can be deferred. So the Hertz is looking for people who are trying to solve practical, hands-on issues. An example of that might be water quality. So there are issues all over the world with the quality of water, with hygiene, with sanitation issues. So they're looking for someone who's out there trying to solve a real life difficult problem. They pay for their graduate school, and if they got, for example, the Fulbright, they could ask for this money to be put on hold until they got back. So if you are a student who is interested in research that has a very practical implication in the real world, this might be a good option for you. There's also lots of DAD opportunities in Germany. I talked about the DAD RISE, but there's the DAD RISE Professional and the DAD Study Scholarships. There's a lot of opportunities in Germany for research. So I can't talk about all those today, but if you are interested in Germany and you're interested in research, just know that many options are available. The National Defense Science and Engineering Fellowship, in some ways, the amounts are similar to the NSF one, but typically the areas relate to national defense, okay? So you have to show that your plan of study is related to it. However, it does not have, you don't have to pay it back by working for the government. So I am going to pause for a minute to see, because we have some time, do you have questions about any specific fellowship? This is kind of an overview. You may have individual questions. The ones that I would encourage you to apply for now would be the Goldwater. If you are planning to do research as your career, you should apply for the Goldwater. If you are interested in applying for research in Germany, you should apply for the DAD RISE. So, do you guys have questions? Yes.
So for the DAD RISE in Germany, what exactly are the what are the for that, or what is it?
The application, you have to pick out what area you want. So it will have a description of the research you will be doing. So there's basically a database. Yeah, and you go in and it might say, doing optic physics research with lasers, and it will give you a more scientific. And then you have to write an essay describing why you're interested in this research, and very similar to probably what you do for an REU and what you bring to the table. And you have to have two letters of reference.
Was that from the REU university or is that overseas?
The letters of reference can be from faculty here, sure. If that's the question. Yeah, they can be from faculty here. The tricky thing about this one is you end up doing it over break. So you need to line your professors up and convince them that while they're on break in their Christmas holidays to go ahead and submit their letters to you. And it's pretty straightforward. You fill a form out, you tell about your interests, you tell about your research goals. The big thing is the essay, and I think you have to upload a CV as well. So if you don't have a professional CV, you might need to develop one of those. But we've had two students who recently won, and they said it was just really good. So we had someone from aerospace, Brett Bornhoff, and then we had Chelsea Harmony win as well. And Chelsea is in chemistry. I want to say chemistry and mathematics.
Just chemistry. Natural products chemistry.
Okay. Yes.
For the Marshall, Mitchell, Rhodes, and Gates in Cambridge in the UK, are those pre-graduate school, or is that opportunities for graduate school?
Great question. For those, they pay for you to go to graduate school in the UK. Okay. So the Marshall and the Rhodes are 2 years. So you get to go over to, for Rhodes, it's Cambridge, and you can pick two master's programs, you can get a second bachelor's degree, you can start their equivalent of a PhD program. So those programs all pay for you to get degrees in the UK.
Go back to one more question.
Yeah.
To go about finding that opportunity, do we go and look for professors ourselves, or do we apply and they match us with a professor for our interests? Is that how it works?
You apply to a specific program. So you would look over the Oxford website and pick out programs that you're interested in. And what I would encourage you to do for those, if you want to shoot me an email, I can send you some links to look at. For those, because, for example, the Marshall, which Marshall allows you to study in the UK, but they're more flexible than the Rhodes. That you can basically go wherever you want in the UK, but you have to write about 6 essays. For Rhodes, you have to have 8 letters of recommendation. So before we let a student jump into that time-consuming process, typically we'll have our faculty look at them, and sometimes they'll say, yeah, this student should apply, or sometimes they'll say, this student is good, but they probably need to wait and do some development before they apply. Other questions? Is there anything you want to add about these opportunities?
No, I don't think so. Okay. I'll just jump in with the REU
so
stuff.
When is the Goldwater deadline?
October 3rd.
And what do you do if you want to apply? And if you don't have that form, you email me. Okay. All right, well, I'm going to go ahead and turn it over to you, and then probably turn my mic off here. My name is Laura Clippard. Again, you can email me. I love working with students, and I'd be glad to talk to you about a lot of these professional opportunities.
Okay. So for the rest of the presentation, we're going to talk about 2 specific NSF-sponsored programs, the REU and the GRFP. So the REU is going to be particularly pertinent for those of you that are contemplating going to graduate school, but you haven't really decided if it's right for you yet. The GRFP is more designed for people that are either already accepted into a graduate program or are definitely planning on going. I'm going to spend most of the time talking about the REU program, but we'll also spend a little bit of time here. We're also going to talk about how you can really put together an effective essay and really sell yourself to get into one of these programs. And for those of you that don't know me, I'm Dr. Drew Sigg. I teach biology for honors. This is my 3rd year here. My background is in ecology and chemistry. The reason I'm talking to you about these programs specifically is because I know firsthand what they're like. So in 2006, there's a little me in the back there. I did an REU at the University of South Alabama. The theme of that REU was all about structure and function of proteins. And what's funny about that is most of the people here were all biochemists or pre-med students. And so they spent the entire time running gels and very molecular-based assays. I was the only ecologist in the group. And so they'd be slaving away in the lab for like 10 hours a day. And then they'd ask me what I did. And I was like, well, I went to the beach. And then I collected a bunch of seagrasses out of the water and like just spent the whole time at the beach. It drove them nuts. But we were still doing protein expression. So the theme was proteins throughout this entire program. And then when I went to graduate school, I did my graduate work at Georgia Tech. And I knew I was interested in both scholarship as well as teaching. And so I got myself involved in Georgia Tech's REU program, both as a coordinator and also sort of an advisor, even though I was only a grad student at the time. And so the theme at the Georgia Tech REU was aquatic chemical ecology. And I'm going to talk about some of the specific things you could have done in that program a little bit later. So I've seen the benefits of an REU program both as a student and as a coordinator. And now that I am here at MTSU, my goal is to try and get you guys into these programs because I know how they work and I know sort of the criteria that people are looking for to get you in. And so sort of the outline of the rest of this is, one, why should you bother applying to an NSF program in the first place? So what are the perks? What opportunities do you get? Where do students go on from there? Again, we're going to talk mostly about the REU program, but then we'll also touch on this idea of the GRFP. And so the neat thing about REUs is that even though the NSF sort of houses the entire program, there are currently 607 different REU sites that you can apply to. And so how it works is every university comes up with one or more REU themes. So like the ones I showed you with structure of proteins or aquatic chemical ecology. So they have this interdisciplinary theme. Some universities will have 4 or 5 REUs running at them simultaneously. And so under this umbrella of this interdisciplinary theme, they'll bring in about 6 to 10 different students and then expose them to what research in that field would be like. And this can range dramatically. So I pulled out a couple of broad examples, and I have a couple specific ones too. So you can go to Johns Hopkins and work on medical robotics and engineering. So they're tying in interests from people that are potentially pre-med students, also engineers, physicists. That would be a good program for you. If you're more of an ecologist, so they've got forest ecology at the Harvard Forest at Harvard University. At the University of Wisconsin, they have one on astrophysics. They have a couple of other REUs as well. UAB is all about forensic science, so tying together psychology, biology, into that program too. So if you'll notice, there's sort of at least two disciplines being represented with most of these themes. And sometimes the REUs themselves can be very exotic. So Mount Holyoke up in Massachusetts, you don't spend any time at the university. You spend your entire time doing polar science in Svalbard. So Svalbard is a couple hundred miles north of the top of Norway. It's where all the polar bears live. And so they go out and do research in polar science for 10 weeks. There's the University of Puerto Rico. You can do tropical ecology and evolution. So hang out in the rainforest for 10 weeks. Northern Kentucky University has a trip to Fiji on anthropology, so you can study the dynamics between biology and culture and anthropology with the native peoples of Fiji. So again, bringing people into lots of different environments as well as different kinds of research and different kinds of science. I thought it would also be kind of pertinent to point out a couple of recent REU students we had at MTSU. Last year when I gave this talk, I actually brought in these guys, but a lot of them have moved on to grad school, so I couldn't get them in this year. Let me kind of pull the room. So I know there's like a cluster of physics people, right? How many of you are physics? There's a huge cluster of physics people. Very well represented. What about biology? Any biology? One lone biologist, good job. Any chemists? Engineers? Physics? Okay, social sciences? Okay, so a smattering of different groups, although the physics you guys are dominating today. Caitlin Stringer did an REU 2 years ago at Texas A&M. Her project mostly revolved around the idea of trying to recalibrate and redesign the way that they actually point the, and I'm probably butchering this because I'm not a physicist, but basically tried to calibrate big fancy telescopes. And so she worked at the McDonald Observatory at Texas A&M. She now is a graduate student, a first-year graduate student at Texas A&M. So some of the connections that she made in her REU program drew her to that graduate field. And so now she's there. We have Noelle Anderson, which, where is she hiding? She's the one sitting down right here. She was a biologist. She went to San Francisco State University. She was working in the computational side of biology, sort of doing a little bit of genome mapping as well as sort of molecular evolution, but mostly through a programming state. She was a senior last year. She has now moved on to University of California, Merced. She just started up there as well, also doing genomic sorts of research. There's also Martina Ramos. She's still a student here. She's graduating this winter. She went to the University of Chicago, did a lot of work in genetics and cell biology, a lot of the genetics of viruses. She basically figured out a way to splice a new gene into E. coli, and she is going to get at least one first author publication as a result of this work. And additionally, her research was so strong that the NSF National Committee brought her in to talk about her research experience afterwards. She's also planning on going to graduate school. She's just sort of a year out from doing that. And then finally, we have Lee Gardner. I'm just excited because we had at least one ecologist. So that's Lee in the back there. She wanted to do work in herpetology and couldn't find any good herpetology programs, so studying reptiles. And so on a whim, she decided to apply to a program run by Duke that was being done down in, I think it was Costa Rica. And she ended up studying how elevated CO2 levels might be changing the growth of vines in the rainforest. And so her whole summer, she spent at a field station in the middle of the tropics. She would take mountain bikes to her field sites, measure photosynthetic rates and other factors from these vines, and then crunch the data back at the lab. She, unbelievably, is getting 3 publications out of her work that she did in that 10-week period, which that is not the norm, but it's still very impressive. And I'm not sure where she's planning to go next. I think she's planning on doing graduate work as well. So lots of different experiences. These were just some of the cohort from 2 years ago. But there are lots of other types of experiences, too. I forgot. And we also have Brooke. So one other thing to note is that the theme of this talk is all about the NSF-sponsored REU program. But with a little bit of digging, you can find very similar programs being sponsored by other institutions that have a similar goal. And so Brooke is a good example of that. She ended up applying for something called the SURF program at the National Institute of Sciences and Technology in DC. She's a forensic scientist, and she basically dug through old medical records and forensics records to try and find some correlations in terms of, I think it was sort of like hit rates on DNA matching or something like that with crime scene investigations. So she spent her whole summer up in DC, and now she's trying to either go into the Tennessee Bureau of Investigation or graduate school after that. So lots of different experiences. And so here's just a partial list of some of the kinds of programs that you can do. We have the natural sciences, so astronomy, earth and atmospheric science, biology, chemistry, physics. But also there are a lot of applied sciences that have REUs associated with them as well. So your engineering programs, education, a little bit on defense, math, psychology and anthropology. The more social sciences, there are fewer opportunities, but there are a lot of sort of interdisciplinary options where it's like biology and anthropology or chemistry and forensic science, where they can tie in a couple of applied and natural sciences together. So lots of different opportunities there. And then I only have one lone biologist, but for those of you that are thinking about going into graduate school, and if you're a pre-med student and you're not sure if you want to go into graduate school or medical school, there's also a lot of good opportunities that expose you to the possibilities in an MD-PhD program. So an MD-PhD is you get both a medical doctorate as well as a PhD. And so these kinds of, so you can apply to graduate MD-PhD programs, but they also have REU-like experiences for this too, where you're doing both clinical and research. So you're going and you're shadowing doctors in a clinical setting, but you're also doing biomedical research at the same time. And so for those of you that are hoping to possibly be a doctor, but you're not sure if you want to do the research side or the clinical side, programs like this are great for you. I have a bunch of handouts that you can grab on your way out. So if that sounds interesting, I have the website. This website links directly to some of these MD-PhD programs for undergrads. But places like the Mayo Clinic and Yale University School of Medicine, Drexel, I think I counted about 25 different undergrad opportunities for this MD-PhD program. So for those of you that are leaning that direction, there you go. Okay. So a couple of details on these programs. First off, this is a hands-on research opportunity. So the way that I pitch it to people is you're being taken from your natural MTSU environment and you're being put in a different research lab at a different school for a 10-week period where you get to see what it's like if you were in graduate school. So they're going to pair you up with either a graduate student or a postdoc, and you're going to do a graduate level project under the advisement of that person for 10 weeks. It's a great way to figure out, do I want to go into research in the first place? But they also spend a lot of time on career development. So they're focusing on how to give a good research presentation, how to make a scientific poster, how to write a scientific paper, how to apply to graduate school, how to apply to medical school, how to network, how to conduct yourself and behave at a scientific conference. So all of these skills that you kind of pick up over your 5 or 6 years in graduate school, they're giving you a head start on all of that through this program. So with both of the programs I was associated with, we'd usually have a 1 or 2 time a week meeting. Usually one of the meetings would be, here's what I found with my research. The other meeting would be, here's how you do, like go to a conference, or here's how you apply to graduate school. In some cases, they'll also do things like GRE prep or MCAT prep. So if you're having to take specialized tests to get into graduate programs, sometimes they'll also have opportunities to sort of train you in that too. The other nice thing is you form a cohort. So most REU programs only have about 6 to 10 people. You really get to know your cohort. Some of you might be working in the same lab. Usually it's one person per lab, but you guys are living in dorms together, you're networking, you're socializing together. And so it builds a little group that actually holds together after you guys move on to your own separate graduate programs. And to sort of promote that, there's also opportunities for social activities. Usually there's at least one weekend field trip and lots of small social activities like going to a professor's house for a barbecue or a pool party, or going out to the movies together, or going to a baseball game. So ways to sort of build cohesion within your group. And the best part about it, well, not the best part about it, but one of the great things is, so it's a 10-week program over the summer, and it pays anywhere from $4,000 to $8,000 on top of all of those benefits. So they're paying for you to get there, they're paying you a monthly stipend, You're gaining all this research experience, and you're getting to see another part of the country. Okay, so lots of benefits there. I'll pause for a second. Does anybody have any questions so far? Okay, otherwise I can go into some more of the particulars. Yeah.
Do they pay for housing?
Your housing is usually covered because they put you in a dorm. That's all taken care of as well. I haven't heard of any where they make you find independent housing. They always have that set up for you. So you have a food stipend and a pay stipend as well. Yeah, so it's pretty financially lucrative as well. So I thought I'd pick apart one of these programs in a little more detail just to give you some context. So this is the splash page for the Aquatic Chemical Ecology program at Georgia Tech. This is the one that I helped to run as a graduate student. And so the philosophy of this particular REU is you can take any two of these words and put them together, and that's the kind of research you could do. So you can do aquatic ecology, you can do chemical ecology, you can do aquatic chemistry. So there's a lot of different possible research topics you can do under this umbrella. And it spans from everything from studying phytoplankton and red tides to looking in salt marshes to going on a research vessel for a couple of weeks and digging up ocean sediments, all kinds of stuff. And so, for example, the lab that I was associated with, we usually would have a couple of chemists, and they would be joining up with natural products chemists. They were trying to find new drugs and new medicines out of red algae out of Fiji. So in one case, actually, one of the students went over to Fiji for 4 or 5 weeks, brought a whole bunch of samples back, and then worked with them. And then others have had these samples shipped in, and then they spend the summer processing them to look for new anti-malarial drugs, anti-cancer drugs, anti-other thing drugs. And then in that same lab, we had students working directly under me, where the students were trying to find chemical defenses out of plants and salt marshes. So they got to work with snails and do feeding assays with snails and do some microbial bioassays as well, also trying to find the chemical basis of defense. So natural products, medicine side, ecology side. Like I said, a couple of students spent most of their time, or at least half of their time, on an ocean research cruise. Cruise sounding lots of fun. It's actually tons of work. So they're working on deep sea hydrothermal vents. They're also working at ocean sedimentation, bacterial diversity down in the depths, things like that. There was one research group that was trying to find ways to clean up coastal oil spills using beneficial bacteria that could break up and eat up those oil residues. This was really big because while I was there, it was right after the BP oil spill, so there was a lot of research going into how to clean up those kinds of big spills. Looking to find out how zooplankton like copepods here can find a mate in the open ocean. How do they track using chemistry? And then there's also some more technological sorts of projects. So one student was trying to design a new microfluidic chip for screening various ailments and drugs. So lots of different options. And that's all under this umbrella of this one REU program. And that's pretty typical. So each student in the program is doing a very different thing, but then that sort of builds up sort of your knowledge of lots of different areas too. Okay, but it's not just work, like I said. Usually there's going to be at least a couple of field trips. So for our Georgia Tech one, we would send them to Sapelo Island. This is actually where I did most of my dissertation work. And so it's a virtually uninhabited island off the coast of Georgia, south of Savannah. Some great salt marshes and beaches, and so they got to spend a weekend seeing what ecological research is like. We took them to a Braves game, we took them to a couple of other things to do in Atlanta, the aquarium, World of Coke, things like that. So there's social aspects built into this too. And like I've said before, you can think about it as graduate school light. So your purpose for being there primarily is research and career development. You're not taking classes, you're not working on the side, you don't have that much free time. But what it does is it really gives you a good snapshot of what graduate school is going to be like and is it right for you. It helps you get your foot in the door for other programs, so Caitlin Stringer being an example of that, where you get to meet a bunch of faculty at another institution, and when it comes time for you to apply, if you apply to that program, they're going to remember you from your REU experience. It looks great on a CV or other resume to show that you've got legitimate research experience to back up anything you're talking about. And then finally, it really helps with your development in terms of being a good scientific communicator. So can you talk about your research in ways that other people understand it? Which is a huge task for some people. Like, it's really easy to fall into this jargon of just babbling about your research so that only other experts will know what you're talking about. they try and get it so you could explain really complex scientific ideas to your scientifically illiterate grandma, right? Like, they're good at trying to get you to communicate science, both written and oral formats. And what I've also done is I'm just highlighting other random REUs as we go along. So biomedical engineering over at University of Illinois. Other benefits, so like I said, I'd say between about 30 to 50% of students that go to an REU are going to end up as an author on a scientific journal. Don't go in thinking that's going to be you. It really depends on how your research project ends up going. So like for me, I was convinced I was going to be able to publish a paper on protein expression of heat shock proteins in seagrasses. And I spent the entire time trying to troubleshoot an assay because we could never get it to work. So after my 10 weeks, I basically determined that seagrasses don't have proteins because we could never get them to visualize. They do actually, but we just couldn't get it to work. You get great letters of recommendation for your grad for going on to other careers. So your advisor gets to know you really well in a way that normal faculty interactions just as a student don't happen. You develop a lot of tools that you can talk about in your personal statement saying, I know how to do PCR, I know how to do this microfluidic assay, I know how to calibrate this piece of machinery. Skills that most undergrads don't have yet, you will have them. And sometimes it can lead directly to offers for graduate programs in graduate school. Over here, so like usually the REU program will end with a poster presentation, so you get to learn how to make a good scientific poster. Again, lots of collaborations with other REU students. I keep highlighting the Georgia Tech one because it's the one I know the best. A couple of other benefits too. So it is a lot of fun, especially if you're trying to if you're on the fence as to what you want to do next. So like maybe you've been studying, focusing on being an ecologist, but you want to get a semester or a summer's worth of experience doing biochemistry to see, do you like biochemistry versus ecology? This is a great way for you to test the waters. A lot of people end up going to very different areas. I never expected to be hanging out in Alabama for 10 weeks, but you get to see different parts of the country. You'll get to make lots of friends and career contacts. So I've stayed in touch with a couple of the people I did my program with almost 10 years ago. And it helps you decide, do I want to go into graduate school? You know, having recently been through it, it's a long time commitment and it can be stressful. It can be a lot of benefits too, yeah.
I was just gonna say, Michelle Kelly, I know we have quite a few students here. Some of you may know that she spent this past summer in Paris, France, doing REU research through the University of Michigan. So, you know, we mentioned in the country, we mentioned out of the country, but you can also go to really cool places like Paris, France.
Yeah. And sometimes you might not even know you're going at first. Like the student we had going to Fiji, she came in thinking she was going to be in Atlanta for the whole 10 weeks, and then she finds out after 2 days that she gets to go to Fiji, which may or may not be a good thing depending on your outlook on life. And so there's another example, the University of Idaho, that's them doing one of their bonding trips where they're going rafting. So if this sounds interesting to you, now I can get into some of the nitty gritty. Okay, so the timeline is kind of funny because like I said, each university runs their REU slightly differently. So the NSF provides like 5 to 6 years of funding for a program. So there's always shifts in terms of what programs are being offered. But from now until I'd say the end of November, the best thing you can do is start looking into possible research areas and possible universities. And so if you go to this long website here, or just Google, literally just type in NSF REU, that's the first page that'll come up. So if you're a Google person, you can just do that. This will bring you to a splash page that will let you search among the 607 different REU sites that are currently active. So if you want to do physics, type in physics. If you want to be more specific and do, I don't know, like classical genetics or molecular genetics, you can type that in and different programs will pop up. It'll lead you to a link to that school's REU program, and that will provide you with things like submission dates, submission materials, information about advisors, information about like GPA requirements, things like that. But each school is slightly different, which is why the best strategy is to start here, find the schools you're interested in, and then find out the information you need, because there's not one master application list. And then at the end of November and then into January, you can start putting your application package together, start looking for references. Usually these REU programs are due between the end of January and the beginning of March, but it's university by university. This is where I can start to come in and help. So two quick announcements. The first is that on the 20th, right? I believe it's the 20th. I have another slide coming up. I have a second sort of follow-up session where we can sit down in a computer lab and find some programs for you. That information is coming up in just a second. So that can get you started with finding the programs you're interested in. And then once you've isolated those programs, I'm happy to meet with you one-on-one and help you put together, like find references, put together your personal statements, get all your stuff in order to make sure that you're ready to go. And this is where me having helped run the one at Georgia Tech for a couple of years really comes ends up being helpful, because might seem a little critical the first time you see it, but I'm good at cutting out the fluff from your articles and your personal statements and making them sound less like a English essay and more like a I want to do research kind of essay. And usually it'll take two or three back and forth, but then you have a really strong essay to send out. So you send out these applications in January, February, or March. You should probably plan on applying to between 3 and 5 different programs to hedge your bet. And keep in mind, and then you should hear back between March and May as to whether or not you got in. It differs university to university. Some people hear back within like a week. Some people, they don't hear back for 2 months. It's just the nature of the program. And one other thing I wanted to note here is think about what the theme of the program is and use that to kind of do a cost-benefit analysis with what schools you apply to. So like Alabama A&M has this program in forestry where they go to China. So people that are looking for a study abroad experience are all going to be gravitating towards that program. So my guess is that that will have far more applicants than a program in North Dakota or Alabama or Texas. And so it's fine to apply to some of these international ones, but I would hedge bet a little bit and also plan on applying to some within the United States or within states that you normally wouldn't think about going, because the application pool may be smaller. So you can have a safety, if you will. So a couple of tips and statistics. So usually there are about 6 to 10 different students in your program. Sometimes it's a little bit more, rarely is it less. And it is competitive, so you should be looking at having around a 3.2 or above for your GPA. They will make exceptions on that if you have sort of personal reasons for it being lower. But generally speaking, you want to be a 3.2 or above. They're a little picky with what kinds of students they take. So if you're a junior currently, you are going to be the ideal candidate for them. If you've got like one, so by junior, like one summer left to go before you graduate. Sophomores can be relatively competitive. If you're only a freshman, you can apply, but don't get your hopes up, because they usually are looking for people to have built in a little bit more experience before they go into it. Okay, so juniors, best chance. Sophomores, pretty good chance. Freshman, don't get your hopes up. Now, if you're a senior and you're planning on graduating, like let's say you're a senior now and you're planning on graduating in the winter, they probably won't take you once you've graduated, so that's not going to work out so well. But the GRFP that we're going to talk about in a second, that might be more useful. And expect to be treating this as a job. You're going to be doing this full time. So you're going to be in that lab for almost 40 hours a week, 30 to 40 hours a week, and you're also doing a couple of research development and career development classes on top of that, where you're meeting and talking about how to conduct yourself as a scientist. So you're not going to have too much free time to go wandering around the city. It's full time. The NSF makes no bones about the fact that they look for diversity in their programs. So kind of like Laurel was mentioning earlier, having historically underrepresented groups, if you are one of those, you will have a slight advantage. So that can include minorities, but it also includes things like first generation or non-traditional students. That's not to say that if you don't fall under one of those categories, you won't get in, but it's just, it can be an additional plus. So, and the NSF is pretty upfront about that. They also are trying to help students that wouldn't normally be able to do research get that opportunity. So if you think about MTSU, we have 20,000 plus students. There's only so many research spaces available in a chemistry lab or a physics lab or a biology lab. And so if you want to get research but don't have space to do it here, you're going to be looked upon favorably when you're applying to this program. Because they're trying to get these experiences for you. And then the last thing is that it's only open if you are a permanent resident or citizen of the US. And again, once you've graduated, you're also off the list. So usually, let's say you found 3 to 5 programs and you're ready to apply. The main things they're going to ask for are transcripts. Some schools and some mentors will care more about your GPA than others. And I can speak to that from Georgia Tech. I remember there were one or two advisors who were like, I will only look at, like, you can filter the applications, and they would only filter to see people with a 4.0. And those are the only ones they would read. Those aren't usually the best advisors to work with anyway, so I wouldn't worry too much about it. The more useful thing is being able to read through a cohesive personal statement. But be aware that some faculty will be like that. And depending on the school you're applying to, sometimes they have higher or lower GPA thresholds. The other component that usually comes up is going to be a personal statement. This can vary a little bit by school to school. Usually it's about 1 to 3 pages. And this is your big selling point. This is where you can show that you're mature enough to apply for one of these programs. And this is also where I can probably help you the most. So you're trying to say, this is the kind of research I want to do, and here's how I can do it in just a couple of pages. Do avoid, and I have a whole little thing on this, avoid the, ever since I was 5, I wanted to be a blah. Like, I wanted to be a doctor ever since I was 5, and my dog Skippy died of cancer, so I want to be a cancer biologist. Like, 80% of the applications that come through have that narrative, and they don't really tell us anything about you as a researcher. It sounds harsh, but it's true. So tailor it to the program you're applying to, and show why you want to be there in the first place. And we'll talk about that a little bit more in just a second. And then you usually need 2 or 3 letters of recommendation. Look for people that can speak to what you want to do in your career and your academics. Don't pull up your pastor, don't pull up your parents' best friend or other, like the guy you worked for at a smoothie place when you were in high school. Like, they can't speak to you as a researcher. Link up with faculty members or other academics that can speak to your research and academic credentials. And if you've had previous research experiences, by all means, sneak this into your personal statement. Sometimes they'll explicitly ask for a separate statement, but think back to the labs and research you've done so far. So maybe you haven't been doing one-on-one research with a faculty member here, but maybe in your organic chemistry class, you did an authentic research project. Or you've learned how to use PCR or some other piece of equipment through your other courses, tie that into your personal statements, because it shows that you can talk about scientific instrumentation and research and that you've actually been exposed to this stuff. They don't expect you to be an expert, but if you know what it is and can talk about it, that's even better. And so the other sort of tips I have are start early, do your research, and also think about who you might want to work with at that site. So when you go onto the REU website and you pick out different schools, they'll tell you, here are the faculty members you can work with, here's how you can apply, here's what we need, here are the due dates. Keep a little sheet that writes all that information down. Link up with a mentor. You can find me, you can talk to other people in your major to develop and work on those personal statements. Don't just blow it off until the last week. You're gonna need a little bit of tweaking to get this right. And then finally, hedge bet. Look for a couple of programs that are interesting to you. Again, everybody wants to go to Fiji, but you can have just as good of an experience, if not better, in Alabama or Montana or New Mexico, right? So consider where you want to go. These are the images from South Alabama where I did my REU. This is the seagrass tank room where I'd bring all these guys back. So just other areas. They had a little sea lab too, which is fun. So when you go onto these REU websites, you'll oftentimes find pages like this, where here's a list of all the different possible faculty you can work with. They have links so you can click and then read about their personal research interests, and you can identify specific people you may or may not want to work with. If you sneak their names and a little bit about what they do into your personal statements, it then shows, hey, I took the time to read about your program, and they'll remember, like, faculty are suckers for getting sort of their name mentioned, right? So if you mention somebody like, oh, I remember that guy, he liked what I did, maybe we should bring him in. So tie in a little bit more about what they do for each program. So in terms of these personal statements, like I said, almost all of them end up reading the same or have this very similar design. So it'll be like, ever since I was blah, I've always wanted to succeed in why. So like, ever since my grandpa died of cancer, I wanted to study cancer biology. And from a scientific perspective, that kind of narrative is relatively boring, and it kind of comes off as disingenuous. So even if it's a true statement, it doesn't show very much creativity. And that sounds harsh, but it's true. And so what they really care about in these personal statements is, why do you want to come there, and why should they spend $8,000 to $10,000 to keep you there for 10 weeks, right? How is this specifically going to get you ready for a career? Who's going to help you do this? What have you done previously? How will the REU help you develop that? That's the stuff they care about. They don't care about grandma suffering from a tumor. And then, so basically, qualifications and experiences are way better than your hopes and your dreams. Again, I like cutting the fluff out of things. This is pretty close to a statement that I actually read when I was at Georgia Tech. So I remember when I was 5 and I went to the aquarium, seeing the dolphins mystically swim in unison convinced me that one day I would also want to study dolphins as a marine biologist. We have a lot of marine biologists there. I've taken many classes to complete my biology major. I got an A one time. I also have many hobbies spelled incorrectly, like swimming and guitar, and it's always made me be the person I want to be. I work in a cafe, which has improved, also spelled wrong, my teamwork skills and my ability to work with other people, right? So it's like all of this stuff, nobody cares about. And you start getting somewhere useful, but then you never expand on it. So like, I've read many statements like this, and by and large, you think you're looking like this, and you really look like this, right? Like, you're just not getting the gist of the program. So some of the problems with that, there's no real direction. It just sounds like a stream of consciousness sort of essay. There's inconsistent type tenses and typos. You haven't proofread the document. There are no specifics. Nothing about that statement said, I want to go do the REU at University X. And nothing really is speaking to your specific credentials. Wanting isn't good enough. You have to explain how you're capable. So the editor or the person reviewing these will say, well, they didn't put any time or effort into this, so why should I expect them to put time or effort into the program? Instead, and I'm not going to read this whole thing, you can write something more like this, where you can say, yes, I have some extracurriculars, like volunteering at an animal shelter, but then you can say, where I administer vaccinations and run clinical PCR, so you're sneaking in actual research experience in with what you've done previously, right? You can say, I haven't done any proper research yet, but I have taken these courses where I got to learn about the aseptic technique and how to culture microbes and things like that. I want to do my REU at your school because I want to be able to study this specific question with this specific person. I want to do these things because it will prepare me for a career or going into graduate school. So you're sneaking in examples, what you've done previously, why you want to do it here, what you hope to get out of it, things like that. And again, it sounds logical and sort of straightforward, but you'd be surprised. So specific examples are good. No fluff. It's not an English essay. Excessive use of adjectives is never necessary. No typos. It's been proofread. You're specifically targeting one REU program. You can change that statement a little bit from school to school. You're expanding on what you want to do next. You've made a compelling statement. This is why I should come. And so it's all relevant. And so that, there's about one like this for every 10 to 15 that is like the first one. These are the ones that stick out in your mind. And so a couple of conclusions here. So again, if this is interesting to you, great way to figure out if you want to do research. Paid, you get to travel, you get look have this nice line on your CV, you might get a publication, you've got plenty of time to work on it, you can get plenty of help on it as well. Again, we have packets where you can grab it, but we have a link to the NSF splash page for the REUs. There's my contact info, it's also on the handout. And if you want to see what kinds of programs are available for you specifically, we'll be meeting on Tuesday the 20th in room 118 down the hall here from 4:15 to 5:15. So in this, what we'll be doing is we'll find that splash page. We'll try and find a couple of programs suited to your interests and figure out what specifically do you need, okay? I'll put one caveat in here in that my wife is due at the end of the month for our first kid. And so if that happens, like the 19th, I probably will have to reschedule this, right? So this should happen beforehand, but if you're interested, we'll let you know if that gets rescheduled. Okay, so before I go on, this one's a little less pertinent for most of you, but it might be pertinent for some of you. But I want to know, do you have any specific questions about the REU program as it stands currently? Does it sound like something you'd be interested in doing? I see some nods. So for those of you that are nodding, please follow up with me. I'm happy to help you get into these programs, or at least try to get you into these programs. I think it's a great experience. It's a great way to figure out if this is the right career path for you. And it's a lot of fun. Okay. So any other questions? Okay. So I'm going to go through a couple of things here real quick. How many of you are seniors or are pretty set on going into grad school at this point? Okay, good. So there's a couple of you. So the other part of this talk is about the GRFP, or the Graduate Research Fellowship Program. Ms. Clippard mentioned this as the golden ticket, so I'll explain why that's the case. This is pretty much required writing for your first year in graduate school, but you can also apply as an undergrad. And so, again, it's targeting the same kinds of STEM fields that the REU is, so we've got our natural sciences and math and engineering. And it's a proposal for you to do a research project, and you write it either as a senior as an undergrad or within your first 2 years of as a grad student. You can apply to it multiple years, so you can use it as a practice round this time, and if it doesn't work out, you can still apply again when you're in graduate school. Again, it only applies to citizens in the US. It's very competitive, so any first or second year STEM graduate student worth their salt will be applying to this. So there are thousands of applicants for it. They only give out about 2,000 per year. So the deck is stacked a little bit against you, but that being said, if you get it, you can go pretty much any graduate program you want to. Also, it's a really good way to sort of develop your ability to write a scientific grant. So what happens is most graduate programs, you're already getting your tuition paid for. This is going to take that off the hands of the school that you've gone to, and NSF pays for it instead. So that gives your university a little bit of financial relief, and they also give you a healthy stipend. So your salary is going to be $32,000 on top of going to school. That lasts for 3 years. That's enough to get a lot of your preliminary research done. They also add in additional things for like research materials and support, so up to $12,000 more there. They work with you for professional development at the graduate level. And lots of clever people have started off as GRFPs. So when I was at Georgia Tech, we had one of my colleagues got it, and a couple of us got honorable mentions, which is still pretty good. Yeah. And
we've had a student win. She didn't win while she was here, but she won while she was in graduate school.
Right, and that's typical. Like applying as a senior undergrad, it's going to be really hard. It happens, but it's going to be tough. But for those of you, like I said, that are planning on going to graduate school anyway, you're probably going to have to apply for this guy anyway, so at least now you've heard about it. But the cool thing is it gives you an opportunity to develop your own project, figure out what kind of research you could do, and pitch it. Like you're doing a sales pitch for this research project. And the cool thing is, let's say you pitch your whole GRFP around seagrass proteins or whatever, and you get that fellowship. You don't have to do anything associated with what the proposal actually was. You can completely turn it on its head and do something else. But you've shown that you have the intellectual merit to be successful, and that's what they care about. Usually helps if you're doing the same kind of thing, but you don't have to. So what do you need to do for this particular proposal? So there's an online application through a government site called Fastlane. You have to write 2 essays, you have to provide your transcripts, and you have to get 3 letters of reference. The part that I'll focus on here are these essays. So it will be an opportunity for you to put together the most concise writing you've ever had to do. So you have to write a 3-page personal statement, which sort of says, why are you going to grad school? What are you going to contribute to society if you get a PhD or a master's? What have you done previously that drew you towards this particular kind of program? What have you done? So how have you been involved in your community? What kind of civic engagement have you done? How has your research benefited so far? And how are you going to help promote science in the public if you get this reward? So they're really interested in community engagement. So if you can sneak in ways where my research will help this group or that group, those kinds of things look really good in your personal statement. And then the trickiest one is your research statement. So you have to find a way to condense 5 years worth of research into 2 pages. And so it is the tightest, most concise scientific writing you'll ever have to do. So you're proposing an original topic. You're not just piggybacking off of something else, something you'd like to pursue in graduate school. You're going to talk about how you're going to accomplish it. What are the methods? What are the analyses? What are the statistics, et cetera? And again, how is your project specifically going to help contribute to society? So in both cases, they want to see how are you giving back if you get this reward or this award. And it boils down into, does the applicant have intellectual merit? So are you competent enough to do this research? Do you know what you're talking about? And can you communicate it? So things like your creativity, is it a doable project, or are you just being completely unrealistic? And then secondly, your broader impact. So how does your research benefit society? So is it a good project? Have you thought it through? Will it benefit society? That's what they care about for this, this grant. And generally speaking, even with other types of graduate fellowships, these are the two main areas that they're looking for. Can you do research? How is it going to help people? So things like, are you developing your teaching? Are you bringing this into the community? Are you increasing scientific literacy? Things like that. Are you engaging minorities in your research? Are you bringing it back to other communities? Things like that. You want to talk about both of these things in both of your statements. Even though it seems like this is the research and this is the personal statement, you really want to bring both together in both statements. And so a couple of tips and tricks. This website here is sponsored by the University of Missouri. They give a whole bunch of insights into what reviewers have seen that come through the pipeline. So tips as to how to put your proposal together. The other thing is that there are literally hundreds of different people that are going to be reviewing these different applications. They've got 10,000 coming in. They need hundreds of people to read them. And so it's a little bit of a crapshoot as to who you're going to have on your committee reading your paper. As an ecologist, I found out afterwards that I had like a physicist and like a cell biologist who had no interest whatsoever in ecology. And one of my downfalls was I didn't sell it well enough as a broad impacts kind of thing, and that hurt me. So you want to make sure that your essay statements can be are scientifically literate, but also can be read by a broad audience. So don't bore them down in details. And so you want to find a way to make yourself stand out. Again, it's hard. It's a difficult fellowship to get, but it is excellent training for any other applications you may have to put together. In terms of the personal statement, again, you're going to break it down into three main pieces. You have an introduction where you're selling yourself. You're talking about why you're capable and intelligent. Your body is saying, here are my ambitions. This is what I want to do. Here's how my research is going to help with that. And then finally, you sell yourself again. So like tell them again sort of deal. With regards to the research statement, you want to talk to a faculty member to really put together that project and do a little bit of a literature review to know what you're talking about. In your statement, you're talking about, here's anything I've done previously. If you've published something before, that's great. Again, that'll come more when you're in graduate school. State what your question is and how you're going to do it. And then why it's valuable. Why would we care? Why would a farmer in Iowa want to know about your research? Right? And then reflect on how is it going to contribute to society? Okay. And then this says, this is why all this could lead to a PhD level proposal. Okay. And then also, yeah, make sure you cite everything. It's a biggie. And like I seem to be harping on this, but like literally if you go on the GRFP website, they specifically say like, we need to know what are they doing, how are they doing it, how will we know if it worked, and why is it successful? Like, these are all the same points for this intellectual merit and how it's going to engage in society. So they're trying to take you from that, right? I have no idea what I'm doing. They're looking more for the Bill Nye's, right, of the world, where can you even science? Like, they want to see that you're capable of talking about this stuff. And so to tie this sort of together, doing something like an REU will then give you the skill set like for these goals that will then allow you to be able to put together a competent GRFP. So they kind of go hand in hand a little bit. And so is it worth it? Like I said, it's really hard. It's showing ambition if you've done it as an undergrad. Sometimes you can even write about that in your personal statements when you're applying to grad school. Like, I applied for a GRFP. They won't be surprised if you didn't get it, but that shows initiative at the graduate level. And it's a golden ticket. So you win a GRFP as an undergrad, you can take it to any institution, ask an advisor, say, hey, I have 3 years worth of funding, do you want to take me on? And they will say, yes, I do. And then you'll get right into the lab. And you can do basically whatever you want if you've gotten it. You can change it around. Okay. The timeline is scary, right? So you have a month if this sounds appealing to you. Depending on your discipline, you have different due dates. Again, I have a packet of info for this too. Your reference letters wouldn't be due until November. So For a lot of you, this is just something to keep on in the horizon. You might not be applying for it this year, but keep it in the back of your mind because it's really, really useful. And then to finalize all of this, NSF, if you're a freshman to a junior, you're looking for research experience, go for the REU. If you're getting ready to go into graduate school, consider applying for the GRFP. Okay, and that is that. So I will take any questions you have at this point. Otherwise, you're set. Okay. Any questions?
Yep. You said you had a handout on the MD PhD program.
Well, so if you grab the REU packet, it's got the link to the, so what it is I think it's the, I forget what society hosts it, but they've gone around and already found all those potential MD PhD fellowships, and they've compiled a list. And so if you go to that website, they'll have all those programs listed. Some of them are REUs, some of them are not.
Okay.
But they all have that same kind of vibe to them.
Okay.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
I was wondering if you have a moment afterwards if I could talk to you.
Yep, absolutely. I'll stick around for as long as I need. If you have questions you just want to ask one-on-one, that's fine too.
I'm going to say it one more time. You won't win if you don't apply, okay? You would be surprised. We have a lot of students who attend workshops, pick up information, but both for the Goldwater, which I mentioned earlier, and for the REUs, you have to take the time to do the applications. There's a saying that 90% of life is showing up. 90% of winning fellowships is actually doing fellowships, so you have to take the time to.
So we've been running this, this is our third time giving this presentation. The first year, we ended up having 7 people meet and apply for REUs. 5 of the 7 got it, which is pretty good. The second year, we only had like 3 people show up, or not to this part, but like 3 people actually follow through, and they only met with us like 1 time, and we had 1 of them get it.
Yeah.
So like, it's on you if you want to do it. We're happy to help. You just have to let us know what you're up to. You're free to go. Thanks for coming.